Dear John Malkovich, pardon me for taking time off from sending you great movie plot ideas, but I had to start making some dough. What with the economy tanking, things has been rough here lately in Dunnell in Florida. Me and Cletus and some of the boys got to talking about it, and we decided we needed to get some real jobs going here. We figured them jokers at the Chamber of Commerce wasn't going to be much help, because all they's good at is thinking of slogans to get people to come here. For a while there, they was using Dunnell in Florida, the bass fishing capital of the world, but too many serious fishermen was saying things like, "Say what?" Cletus said maybe we ought to try sticking to the truth for a change, and we kicked that around for a while. But all we could come up with was stuff like, "Dunnell in Florida. It's not actually right up inside the asshole of the universe." Or maybe, "Dunnell in Florida. A great place to go if there's paper out on you in another state." Now, I understand that them chamber people has got to maybe bend the truth just a little teeny-weeny smidge from time to time. Most of them is developers, and most of them is rich, and most of them got rich just by renaming stuff. Right close hereabouts, we got the Cinnamon Patch at Stickingham Ridge, which used to be 1,500 acres of logged-over turpentine pines till they slapped up 3,000 salmon-colored pewter cottages. And we got the Landons at Misty River, which us locals used to just call Hellhole Swamp. And God knows we've been patient with all them packs of goblin old zombies that come down here and bought them shacks. Anyhow, I finally come up with a plan. Boys, I told them, we got to get that fishing tourism thing going again, and we got to get us some manufacturing-type jobs going at the same time. They was kind of skeptical when I told them our new slogan was going to be Dunnell in Florida, the tackle manufacturing capital of the world, but I laid it all out for them. A lot of Yankees are still coming down here to fish, right? Lots of nods. And they want to catch big fish, right? Uh-huh. Huge fish. Oh, yeah. And they ain't going to catch no monster fish unless they've got the right lure. Well, sir, boys, we're going to sell them lures. We're going to sell more lures than all them other lure companies put together. Time I explained it all to them, every damn buddy was itching to get started doing his or her part. And nobody complained about me and Cletus getting the best jobs because we thought it up. Now, there's a little cove on the Withlacoochee River, and that sumbitch is dead. D-E-A-D, dead. If you go into it, you can tell right away that something ain't right. You just can't quite put your finger on it at first. It's dirty in the same way that the sidewalks in them big cities gets dirty. I guess the word I'm looking for is grimy. There ain't no obvious source of pollution, but I ain't never had a single nibble in there, and neither has anybody else I know. The main river's thick with water birds and turtles. Ain't never seen a one of them in that cove neither, and nobody, local anyway, fishes it. So me and Cletus figured it was perfect. Come first light, we was sitting right inside the mouth of that old turd pool in Cletus's John boat. Had us a couple old rusty Zebcos and a thermos of dark roast, and we was sitting there smoking cigarettes and waiting to catch the new world's record largemouth bass. Now that may not sound like much of a plan to y'all, but we've done gone and cheated just a little bit because we already had the new world's record largemouth bass. All 28 pounds of that sumbitch, wrapped up in a blanket and stuffed under Cletus's seat. Well, sir, I probably ought to tell you that we wasn't expecting the new world's record largemouth bass to put up that much of a fight, being made out of rubber and mylar and that epoxy stuff and all. But we was going to be doing all the work making her look like she was a kicking and a flopping and a slinging water all over us when we lifted her and yanked her into the boat. Now, I grant you that that puppy wouldn't fool Stevie Wonder from anything much under 100 foot, but from where them boats would be going by out in the main channel, she would have fooled God his own self, and we figured he'd probably set this one out. Long about sunup, the walkie-talkie started crackling, and it was Leroy, and he'd got himself all excited. He'd been hiding in the bushes up by the city boat ramp, picking out future customers for us in advance. "There's a couple of jokers just pulled out," he hollered, "and they got Minnesota tags and one of them high-sider walleye boats them Yankees seem to go for. I swear to God, Bubba, they's dressed up like a couple of Canadian bonefish guys. Got them shirts with the little peg-down Batman capes on the back and them astronaut blowholes under the armpit, and they got rods you could fight a marlin with." Well, me and Cletus was up in a flash. He turned us around for the perfect angle. I slipped a hook into a ring we'd put under the offside gunnel and got ready to rear back and commence to screaming. And when them jokers hove into view, I let loose a howl and bent that Kmart rod double and then some. Jesus H. Rubbernecking Christ on a goddamn pogo stick, Cletus, I yelled. I got me a by God monster. And we commenced to hopping around that boat like a couple of meth heads. And even through all that clattering, we could hear them jokers throttling down to nothing. I cut a glance, and they was pointing and a-jabbering. But when Cletus lifted old Big Mama and pulled her up and she commenced to flopping, I thought both of them old boys was going to have one of them one of them foaming at the mouth fit. Me and Cletus jammed up hip to hip with our backs to them and got Big Mama tucked away in her blanket and then started high-fiving on each other and carrying on like a couple of drunk cheerleaders. Sure enough, them old boys come motoring up all friendly-like but damn near stretching their necks off trying to look down into our boat. My God, buddy, the older of the two said, that was the biggest bass I've ever seen in my life. You might have a record there. Could we see it? Cletus and me got us that all flustered-pated look. Well, hell, mister, I told him. One's that size, we just put them back. Then we give each other that Yankees they must get their brains sucked out with a straw at the state line look. Maybe you fellas can come down here and fish for fun, but we's looking for something big enough for dinner. Then comes the cast. Slow sidearm. Hell, any dang fool can catch them that size, especially in this place. You just gotta have the right lure. Let it sit. Let it sit. What kind of lure would that be? Twitch it now. Just a little. Green chunker. Twitch, twitch. I don't believe I'm familiar with that one. Who makes those? Reel up that slack now. Slow. Well, hell, mister. Green chunkers is famous. Old Harley makes them. Sells them up at that tackle shop back there by the bridge. I reach down real casual-like and flip open the lid of that rusty old two-tray Western Auto tackle box. And I don't keep nothing in there but green chunkers. Every size from 2-inch to 6-inch. A pair of gleaming trebles dangling from every one of them beauties. I grabbed the biggest one to hold it up for him. Them littlest ones is okay for up to maybe 5 pounders, but the jumbo here's what we usually toss. Hell, they ain't but $15.95. But that looks like a piece of garden hose with hooks on it. Bam! That condescending but friendly grin of mine slammed straight over into that you ruined my daughter and they're about to put us in the same cell kind of smile. Well, I reckon we's too dumb to make them fancy bass lures down here, right, Cletus? Cletus is up, his right hand shoved down into the front pocket of them baggy old khakis, and his voice is like ice. Yeah, dumb. Thank God we get fellers like these coming down here, showing us ignorant hillbillies what to use for biggins. Fire up that Johnson, Bubba. We got to get to one of them big city tackle shops and get us some of them fancy-ass factory-made lures before we get skunked. We motor off the ways, giving them icy look back, so they go blasting back away toward the ramp. And just before they round the point, of course, we hook up to that ring again, and the last thing they see is Cletus setting the hook on another U-boat. Usually by about 10 o'clock, we can get Harley on his cell phone and tell him whether he needs to get on up to the true value for a couple more 50-footers. Sincerely, Boba Joe Jim Bob Beats Jr., big-time tackle marketing executive.
What was that?
That was very strange.
It was very weird.
Peculiar.
It was kind of amusing.
Yes, it was rather funny.
It was incredibly funny.
I loved it.
Yeah, there it is.
Wonder.